bishop in San Antonio, San Andreas. And I'm really surprised at the growth of 50 years. I know that at the beginning, Bishop Latigue found it very difficult. He really started literally, numerically, from zero, from scratch. He had no seminaries. I know that because when the boys used to go to our youth center, was one of the first seminarians of Bishop Latigue, Jimmy Weyro. And because the family is very close to the Moscow, as a matter of fact, his younger brother joined us also in the seminary. So, coming here, from a few conversations I had with you, I was really awed by the growth of this diocese, so beautiful. You are 50 years, just 50 years old. Our diocese in Papua is more than 50 years old, much older than you. And you are many more than us. As priests, how many are you? How many are you? About 130 plus? We are much, much less. And seminarians, I just talked with one of the seminarians here, Franz. He said you have about 70 here. We have only 30. And in theology, maybe less than 20, or 15 maybe. And then the religious. You have how many parishes? 87. We have only 40 parishes and some 20 chaplaincies. Tremendous growth. And the vibrance is full, the life of the diocese. So I really congratulate you on the occasion of this 50th anniversary, and I join in thanking God for having blessed you so much. So as I said, I'd like to talk about this year dedicated to the clergy and consecrated persons, and put it in context. In the context of this, you know already, the 9-year kind of novena preparation to the great jubilee, which we shall celebrate as a people, as a Christian people, the jubilee of 2021. And you know very well the plan that each year since we start 2010, I think. We started each year to focus on a sector of the church so that we can deepen our own reflection in that sector and deepen also our building of the church in that sector, all in view of a renewal. Because a beautiful vision we have of this Jubilee celebration is that after 500 years of Christianity, that we be renewed, and there is so much renewal to be done. And so, in this year, we are focusing our attention on the clergy and the consecrated persons, consecrated life. But sinabi ko ng clergy and consecrated life. I would like to think that the joining of the clergy and the consecrated persons, that because we ran out of years, not of them. But I think it's from the perspective that the clergy and the consecrated persons form the leadership of the church. As a matter of fact, our theme is renewed servant leaders for the new evangelization. Because the fact is that the church is led by the clergy and those consecrated persons. The clergy, the hierarchical leadership, and the consecrated persons, the charismatic leadership. And this is very important that we work hand in hand. Our church needs to have and needs a leadership that is truly effective. A leadership that works. If you remember the first Congress for the clergy held something this time, the theme was renewed country, renewed clergy, sorry, renewed country, renewed church, renewed clergy. Maybe I can go over that. And I think it's very significant. It's not just for alliteration or what, for styling. The concept itself, the country needs to be renewed. Ours is a sick country. Now even more so, I'm sorry. We are the only Catholic country in this part of the world, in Asia. Okay, you say Timor, but Timor is a little bit different. And this part of Asia, of the world that makes up one third of the population. China itself is 1 million plus. India. Not a billion, the rest of us. We are the light, as Pope Paul VI, I think, says, we are the light of Asia. The flickering light of Asia. And that's why the great challenge of the church to bring that light, now we talk about evangelization. What a great responsibility, what a great task. And yet, the most Christianized people, and we are one of the most corrupt countries of Asia. How can you understand that? There's a dissonance there. We who are taught the highest standard of morality are the most corrupt. Among the most corrupt. That's the word. There's so much need for renewal in this country. And who can renew this country? Our faith. The church. But then also the church seems to need renewal herself. Without scandal. You know, the basic virtue, human virtues, we are wanting. We condemn corruption in government, but the way we handle our, manage our finances, even now. I don't want to go to that. We need to say that the great need for renewal. The country can be renewed only if the church can impact, can influence this country. And we go further or deeper in the church can be renewed only if the leadership is renewed, the clergy. This is the very frustrating situation we are finding ourselves in. That's why we ask, has the church failed in these 500 years? Do we have really any influence? Do you think that our leaders come from our Catholic schools and universities? So, the leadership itself, and that is a fact. I always say, when I was with the society, and I would talk to them at our communities, and I would talk to the rectors. I always insist, dear rectors, be real rectors. The community is as good, it's as good only as its rector. And the same, the parish is as good as its parish priest. If you have here a parish priest that is zealous, really alive, and holy, the whole parish is alive, holy. There's nothing talented or gifted, St. John Mary Daniel. If, same, the community, if you have a good leader, the whole community rises. So, the importance of this year, that we as leaders, the true leaders, that's because we had a Congress for the clergy, maybe we should really have a Congress for the clergy and consecrated persons, because the leadership is in both of us. As we shall read from the Relaciones, the hierarchical church, which is the bishop, the priests, live in the teaching, live in the worshiping and in the shepherding of the community. The consecrated persons live by the prophecy and witnessing. The very meaning of consecrated life is, or the very heart of consecrated life is, sequela Christi, the following of Christ. So that Christ may be proclaimed, not by words, but by our very life. And if you remember the message of Pope Francis during the year of consecrated life, wake up the world. Wake up the world. Tell the world there is so much more than this life that is offered by the world. There's more to life than just riches, relationships, or atonement. Anyway, so this very beautifully treated in Udre Relaciones. And I think that waking up the world, we'll have to start with the task of waking up people, that has to start with waking up the churches. Maybe that's a great service you can do to us priests. Wake up the priests. Leadership by example. The icon is the washing of the feet. That's the leadership of example, by example. Even before the leadership of servanthood. I have given you an example. You have seen what I do. Do likewise. And that is especially for you in the consecrated life. The example that Christ is really reincarnated in your own persons and in your own life. And you can really wake up the world and the church. Before we go to Mutre Relaciones, I'd just like to share with you an experience we have in the diocese where I was before, the last year. I was sharing with our priests at table because I was asking them, do you have SLA? Because whenever I put I want to benchmark the other classes, how they do the standard living allowance. Because right now we are working on that in the border, because we don't have anything. We're starting to systematize our finances and then eventually come up with the standard living allowance for the priests. And I heard from the fathers that I talked to at the table that you are also working on your own. And then you're comparing notes, all the best systems, those of the villages, I know that it's passive also. Those in India, they did a very good, they have resources, a very professional life. And then I was sharing to them, the water we had in Kamakala is also good, but very raw. And they were asking what it was, and I was sharing that. For better name, we call our system the all-in policy. When you say, all our priests, they bring in all the fruits of the ministry, they need to say, their stipends, their mass intentions, their honoraria, their salaries, because some of them are directors of school. They pull them in every month, and then they divide the amount equally to all. So at the end of the month, they have as allowance the same, everything. So whether you are a parish priest or an assistant parish priest, whether you are a junior priest or you are a senior, or you have a parish, or you are in the cemetery or other offices, at the end of the month, you receive the same. And this is modeled after we work this out following the spiritual stewardship. But if you remember the parable of the vineyard, where the owner of the vineyard went out and at 6 o'clock in the morning he saw some men idle, he employed them at different times, 9, at 12, at 3, even up to 5 o'clock, the last hour, he brought in workers to the vineyard. And at the end, he gave each one the same amount of full day's wage. So they are doing that, and they were asking how did you come up with that arrangement, and how is it? It was a work actually of the past 9 years. And it works because there is a system, actually it's a fruit of the tithing system that we have. Because when we reviewed our tithing system, when we started to weigh, we tried to diagnose lack of mama. As usual, the Filipino in a school, you start very, very enthusiastic with tithing. And we realized that our first tithing system was just a system, a structure. Any system, if it doesn't have a soul, will not be sustainable. It's just a structure. And so we thought that it had to be moved by something deeper, a soul, a spirituality. And it was just at that time when this spiritual stewardship came to the Philippines. And so we tried to learn it. One of our annual retreats was preached by Father Dan Mahan, who was this book, Neither Gold, Silver or Gold. And then a whole year we underwent the commission of spiritual stewardship, also from people from, there was the St. Thomas More Parish, I think in Denver. They have this this template, and they taught us. So, the system and the spirituality. And everybody's very happy now with that, because your basic concerns for that, the reshuffling is very smooth, because wherever you are assigned, you get the same. And then, wala na yung mga, you're very jealous about your territory, you might have been isa sa Paris, but wala permission or even information. 4 hours na. Wala na, wala na. Because the idea is, we have only one vineyard. Parang yung borderless na ang analysis. We have one vineyard, and we are working for the one Lord, who at the end of the day compensates us with a full day's wage. No? And in the beginning, we were apprehensive if this was working. And you know, the bigger resources of the diocese, the result was really something that surprised us. Average, every month, they get 25,000. And then, you know very well that Negros is a one drop country, no? And so, during the lean months, they call this tiempos muertos, it's low, but then when the bidding season arrives, then the revenues are higher. So the lowest during the low season is about 20,000. And in months like November, December, they go up to as much as 50,000. But then the beauty is that when we do this, we realize that it's self-serving. Okay, yung mga pari, they're taking care of. And maybe it's even too much for a priest, no? That amount. How about our people? And that started us to think about our people. And the beauty is that this spirituality and this culture has trickled down, cascaded down to. So one of the first actions we made was regularize all our employees, because I'm used to montages, all of this down the area, and it wasn't there. So we entered into that, and then the rest. And now they are moving to the total abolition of the island cell, so that we have a tithing system fully in place. And what's beautiful is, as I said, the culture seeps down. For instance, in our schools, you know, besides the fountain, that also gives allowance, teacher's allowance, huh? ES, something like that, 1,000 a month. And, but these are given only to those that are that classes. Huh? So many of our schools, some of our teachers, many are not classes because they are fresh graduates waiting for the exams. Kasi parang jumping board ng mga high schools natin, for the public school slots. Those that receive is 1,000 per month allowance by received by these lab classes. They decided to pull them all together and then invite them so that also the non-pastors could join. So it's a very beautiful spirituality has entered the culture. And then other many, I would say many, citing the other volunteer words today. You know how this came about? When I asked the priest, why did you decide about this? And it was, what they said is, because that is how the religious live. And we want to see that life is livable. And it will be livable. That is the leadership that the church expects from us. Without saying much, your life, prophecy, that is very strong, and that is felt when it is real. So this, I hope really that in this year we deepen our reflection on how we do leadership in the church. I'd like now to proceed to the mutue relaciones, and I'll try to be as short and as clear as I can. What is this document, mutue relaciones? You know very well that in the past, even up to now, there have been very difficult situations in the church life that affect the relationship between the bishop and the religious, between the diocesan clergy and the religious. There are many areas, gray areas, that when they are cleared, can cause tensions and even irritations. And that is why on the occasion of the 10th anniversary of the great conciliar documents, Christus Dominus, which is the document on the bishops, and the Perfecti Caritatis, which is the document on consecrated life, the congregations, both the congregation of bishops and the congregation of religious and secular institutes, that was the old name, now it is congregation on the institutes of consecrated life and societies of apostolic and apostolic, something like that. So they had a joint general assembly in order to thresh out these very contentious situations, how to handle them. And that was from October 16 to 18. And this was also participated in by the International Association of Major Superiors, both men and women, and also the National Conferences of Bishops. And so they did a workshop. And the result of this is this document, which is really very, very historic. And the workshop just focused on three questions. What bishops expect from religious? Straight to the point. Bishops, what do you expect from the religious? And likewise, what religious expect from bishops? How do we really understand our role in the church? And what do we expect from both sides? No? And the third is, what means shall we use to arrive at an orderly and fruitful cooperation between bishops and religious, both in the diocesan and also on the national and international level. So I think very, very important questions and very comprehensive. And so what came out is this very, very precious document, Mutual Relations. The name itself, Mutual Relations. And it's about 30 pages, and I'd just like to maybe give you the framework and then also just some salient points. The first part is the doctrinal part. Because before we discuss on how we need to relate to each other, we have to be very clear about who we are in the church. So the first part is a beautiful synthesis of the ecclesiology according to Vatican II. You are very familiar with the ecclesiology of Vatican II. Vatican II sees the church as mystery, communion, and mission. So, first mystery, that this church is not just a human organization or a sociological phenomenon. There is more to it than this. It is divine. It's a divine institution. Because I like to quote directly. It is a new people which vivified by the Holy Spirit, assembling Christ in order to have access to the Father. The members of this people are gathered from all nations and merged into such intimate unity that the real newness transcending the human order is inherent to it. Only in this transcendent perspective can we rightly interpret the relationships among various members of the Church. The element on which the uniqueness of this nature is based is the very presence of the Holy Spirit. And this is a very typical formula in the documents, that this Trinitarian dimension of the Church is willed by the Father, for the Father's purpose. And so he sent the Holy Spirit to vivify it. And Christ makes it his own body. And so we are one body, and as parts of it, we belong to each other. And here we enter into communion. So we are all in that one reality, mystical reality. In the mystery of the Church, unity in Christ involves mutual communion of life among its members. And so really, later, as with the rest of the members, we are one, organically one. The very life-giving presence of the Spirit builds up organic cohesion in Christ. Indeed, he unifies the Church in communion and in the works of ministry. Not only in our life together as one body in Christ, but also in our action, our acts together in our ministries. He bestows upon her varied, hierarchical, and charismatic gifts, and in this way directs her, and he adorns her with his fruits. And as the beautiful icon that St. Paul gives us, the Church is the body of Christ. The elements then which differentiate the various members among themselves, the gifts, the offices, the various duties, constitute substantially a kind of mutual complement and are actually ordered to the one communion and mission of the self-same body. Consequently, the fact that in the Church there are pastors, laymen, or religious does not indicate inequality in regard to the common dignity of the members. Rather, it expresses the articulation of the joints and the functions of the living organism. And so we find our place in this one body of Christ. And from this, we also see the sacramentality of the Church. The newness of the people of God in its twofold aspect of a visible social organism and an invisible divine presence, intimately united, is similar to the very mystery of Christ. It's a sacrament. The sacrament of Christ. And so it's visible. It's physical. It's hierarchical. It's made up of people, flesh and blood, with specific functions. And it is also charismatic because it's vivified by the Spirit, each gifted with different charisma. And then the third, the Church's mission. Because this was brought about by God, His Church, for a mission. And for just for its own life. All members, pastors, laymen, and religious, each in his own manner participate in the sacramental nature of the Church. Likewise, each one according to his proper role must be assigned an instrument of both union with God and of the salvation of the world. And the mission is the salvation of the world. This union was willed by God. so that together as one body, we fulfill the mission. Holy and vital is twofold aspect in the body. Holiness, holy the church, whether we belong to the hierarchy or are called by it, are cared for by it, are called to holiness. And the apostolate. The entire church is driven by the Holy Spirit to do her part for the full realization of the plan of God, which is the building of God's kingdom. Easter they mentioned, I think, is the one that Pope Francis very strongly wants to put forward. This is the forgotten dimension of the church, the sense of mission. If you notice, the last year of this 9-year plan towards 2021, the last year is the year of mission. Because this is now the full maturation of the church, what you can call it. 500 years we have been gifted with a faith. It's high time that we become a missionary church. This is long, long overdue. The light of Asia must be greater than beginning. You remember all the many talks of Pope Francis, go out to the peripheries, out the church of mission. He used to talk of disciple. Now he says, no, there's no such thing as disciple. Missionary disciple. Mission is a constitutive element in discipleship. Because people say, missionary and disciple. No, that's one. Okay, so this is the ideology. Now, where is the place of the bishop in this organic ecclesiastical communion? Here, I wish I could do this simply. It's very theological. So theological, I myself am confused. Huh? How is this organic communion of the church? It is the work of the Spirit and of Christ. The Spirit, who is like the soul of the body, and Christ is objectively the head. Therefore, the source of the organic cohesion of its members. The organic communion of the church, therefore, is not exclusively spiritual, that is born of the Spirit. The Spirit that unifies even us as human persons, our soul, is what keeps us together. But this, what keeps us together also is the body. Simultaneously, this church is also hierarchic. Inasmuch as by the vital impulse, it is derived from Christ the head. Christ the head is a historical fact. In this manner, the organic communion of the church, both as its spiritual and aspect and its hierarchical, has its origin and vitality simultaneously in Christ and His Spirit. In fact, the Spirit is the Spirit of Christ. So why this very convoluted treatment of the hierarchy, spiritual and the hierarchy? Because it's here where we can understand the meaning of the bishop, the meaning of the pope, the meaning of hierarchy. The Lord Himself set up in His church a variety of offices which aim at the good of the whole body. Among these ministries, that of the episcopate is fundamental to all others. The bishops in hierarchy communion with the Roman Pontiff make up the College of Bishops in such a way that jointly they manifest and carry out in the church sacrament the function of Christ the Head. So in this, the Pope, dimension of this church and conformulate with our bishops. The bishops, both the bishops and the bishops share the ministry through Jesus. And that is the task that Jesus gave to Peter and the apostles. In the person of the bishops then, to whom the priests render assistance, the Lord Jesus, supreme high priest, is present in the midst of the faithful. Bishops, in a resplendent, visible manner, take the place of Christ himself, teacher, shepherd, and priest, and act as the representative, the vicar of Christ, the visible sacramentalization of Christ, the head of the church. Anyway, I think we learned this from the Catechism. So, what's the consequence? Bishops, therefore, furthermore, as members of the Episcopal College, in harmony with the will of the Supreme Pontiff, are united in his namely. So, I skip the functions of the Christ the Head, teaching, leading in worship, and ministry, healing, as one. This has been entrusted by Christ to the hierarchy. And so all the function, all the activities in function of these three ministries, they are all in the bishop, are also very much dependent on the hierarchy. Meaning to say, okay, I'm here, I'll come. You are a consecrated person, so you are religious. I'm not in Papa, but the relationship with the bishop. It's not beyond that. The teaching, the worshiping. Worshiping is about holiness. You know? The purpose of the religious as on the way to holiness, even the plan of how to be holy, is falls under this function. So, in short, it falls on the episcopate to regulate the practice of the evangelical council. This is in judgment. In authentically approving rules proposed to them in such a way that new churches is fostered in them and that specific duties and mandates are entrusted to them. In seeing to it by their concern that institutes upheld by supervisory and protective authority may develop and flourish. In determining the exemption of some institutes from jurisdiction of local ordinaries for the sake of the general good of the universal church, and to better ensure that everything is suitably and harmoniously arranged within them, and the perfection of the religious life promoted. Everything that the religious life is all about springs from the church and from the hierarchy. Our constitutions, they are approved by the church, by the hierarchy. Even our spirituality and order, they are certified by this church. And so what is the consequence? Christ, the head of the ecclesiastical body, the eternal pastor, was given precedence to Peter and the apostles and their successors, namely the Roman Pontiff and the bishops, constituting them sacramentally his vicars, and granting them appropriate charisms. No one else has the power to exercise any function whether of teaching, sanctifying, or governing, except the participation and in communion with them. So that the great, great link of the deep and necessary link of consecrated life to the higher king. If the Holy Spirit is called the soul of the Ecclesial body, no member of the people of God, no matter what ministry he may exercise, possesses personally himself in their totality gifts, offices, and duties, must enter into communion with others. Differences in the people of God, whether of gifts or functions, converge and mutually complement each other for the need for union and vision. All our gifts, all his charisms, are all for the body, the function of the body, for the growth of the body. And instead of all gifts, not only for consecrated life, but you have now movements,